There are a few reasons why you want to secure your Nginx with HTTPS. First of all, HTTPS protects the communication between your browser and the server from being intercepted and tampered with by attackers. Most of the modern browsers will show a warning if you're using plain HTTP protocol, and even Google will increase your rank simply if you switch to HTTPS. In this video, we will create Ubuntu Server 2004 in AWS. Then we will install Nginx and Certbot, define Nginx server block and secure it with Letsencrypt SSL certificate. Since Letsencrypt certificates are valid only for 90 days, Certbot will schedule a systemd timer to run every 12 hours. If you already have Ubuntu server, you can skip this section, otherwise follow along. Every 2 years, the April release is long-term support version. All normal releases, 13.04 and later, only supported for 9 months. All LTS releases, 12.04 and later, are supported for 5 years. On both desktop and server. Support in our case means updates for potential security problems and bugs. Currently, 2004 is the latest release suitable for production environments. First, let's create EC2 instance. Click Launch Instance and search for Ubuntu. Select Ubuntu Server 2004 LTS. Now, based on the expected load, choose the type of the instance. Keep in mind, if you select an instance with only one CPU core, you may face a well-known bug when Nginx fails to start. There is a workaround, but I encourage you to pick instance type with at least two CPU cores. For this example, I'm going to pick T3 Nano with 2 cores and half of the gigabyte memory. Here you need to select the public subnet, which means that the subnet will have a default route to the internet gateway. And you also need to make sure that your instance will get a public IP address from AWS, otherwise you won't be able to access it. We can keep the default storage 8 GB, we are just going to host a tiny HTML page. For production environments, make sure that you rotate your logs properly. They can quickly fill up the disk and break your server. Security group is an analog of firewall. You need to create a new one and allow ports 80 for HTTP and 443 for HTTPS. Also, since we will need SSH access, keep port 22 open. Optionally, you can restrict the source for SSH to your public IP address only. Only the last step left is to review your EC2 configuration and click Launch. To be able to SSH, you need to create a key pair, which is a public and private keys. The public key will be stored on the Ubuntu server, and you will use the private key to initiate an SSH handshake. Let's create a new one, call it DevOps, and click Download Key Pair. Now you can see that our instance is in running state, and we can use the public IP address to SSH to it. However, before you can do that, we need to update permissions on your key. When you download it, it will be open to anyone to read on your development host. You need to set permissions 400, which means only your user can access and read its content. Now to SSH, let's grab the IP address and use -i flag to provide the path to the private key and Ubuntu user, which is created for you. If this is your first time SSHing to the host, you need to add it to the list of known hosts. I always start with updating default Ubuntu repositories by running sudo apt-update. There are a couple of commands available. Apt is designed for end users, human and apt-get may be considered as low level and backend. Usually you would use apt-get in your scripts. To check what version of the package will be installed, you can run the apt policy and then the package name. Let's see what version of Nginx is available out of the box. Well, it's 1.18, which is already considered to be legacy. I don't want to install outdated software. Let's see what Nginx versions are available. We can go to nginx.org and get the list. All the commands that I run in the terminal and links will be available in my GitHub repository in the readme file. The link you can find in the video description. Alright, 1.20 is stable, let's go with that version. Now we need to add Nginx repository to our Ubuntu server. Let's follow the best practice and create a new source list, let's call it Nginx. Add two records here, they're almost identical. Deb lines are relative to binary packages and what we actually will use, and deb source lines are relative to source packages. Source packages are needed only especially if you want to compile some packages yourself or inspect the source code for a bug. Ordinary users don't need to include such repositories, it's just an example. Also, I use VI text editor. You can use Nano if you are more familiar with it. Let's save it and run the sudo apt update again. Most likely, you will get an error. The repo is not signed. There is a straightforward fix. Just add a public key with the error ID. If you rerun the previous command again, it will finish successfully. Let's check now what Nginx versions are available for us. 1.21 is the one that we will install. Focal is the name of the Ubuntu release. You can specify what version of the package you want to install with the equal sign. Let's start the Nginx using the systemctl start command and enable it. When you reboot your server, Nginx will be automatically started. Run systemctl status to check if you have any errors in the output. It's in running state and the output is clean. Let's use the public IP address and see if we can access it via browser. At this point, you need to use HTTP and access port 80. Alright, looks good for now. When you install Nginx in the standard Ubuntu repository, Nginx is configured to follow the traditional Apache setup. There will be sites available and sites enabled directories and updated Nginx conf to include the last directory. We don't have to follow the same approach, but I think many are familiar with that setup, so let's stick with it. Etc Nginx Nginx conf is the main config file for Nginx. At the bottom, we will include sites enabled directory later on. At this point, Nginx will load the default config. Let's check it out. Now create a directory that will contain your HTML files. Replace devops by example.io with your own domain. To avoid any issues, let's update the owner of the directory to be your current user and set 755 permissions on the folder as well. Let's create a simple index.html page. Add the title and the h1 header tag and save the file. Now let's emulate Apache setup. Create sites available and sites enabled directories. The way it works, you create an Nginx config for your web page and place it in sites available. To instruct Nginx to serve your website, you need to create a soft link from sites available to sites enabled. Here is a very simple Nginx server block. The root is pointing to the directory where you have your HTML files. The index directive specifies what file to use as the main one, and server name uses DNS records to route your request to this server block. We specify devops.by.example.io and www.devops.by.example.io. Now let's update the main Nginx config file, scroll all the way down and add include sites enabled. To enable your site, let's create a soft link. You can check the configuration by running nginx-t, it will verify that everything is correct. You can see that the syntax is okay and the test is successful. To reload the config without restarting the Nginx process and causing downtime, run nginx-s reload. The next step is to create DNSA records that map our domain with the Nginx public IP address. The process is similar for most DNS hosting providers. You just need to create a couple of A records. In our case, let's get the IP from the AWS console and go to Google Domains where I have my devops.by.example.io domain registered. For the first record, Apex domain, let's leave the hostname blank, select A record type and set 300 seconds TTL. The second record for the www subdomain, same values. Usually you'll get a notice that the domain names will be ready in 24 to 48 hours. Usually it takes a few minutes. Let's wait 5 minutes and use the dig command to check the DNS resolution. Alright, we have our public IP here. Now let's open the incognito window and enter devops.by.example.io domain. It looks like Nginx configured correctly, but we get a warning that the connection is not secure, since we're not using certificates just yet. Same with www subdomain. Let's install Certbot, it will help us to issue certificates and automate the renewal process. To install it, they recommend using snapd, which is another package manager that helps to install software on different Linux distributions. Most likely, you already have snapd installed on your host. To check, just run snap version. If you don't have installed yet, run the policy and install snapd. ensure that your version of snapd is up to date. Then remove Certbot Auto and any Certbot OS packages if you have any. Finally, install Certbot with a snap. Execute the following instruction in the terminal to ensure that the Certbot command can be run. Use the version flag to check if the Certbot is available on your path. Now, before you go and try to obtain a real certificate, it's a good practice to use Letsencrypt staging environment to test your pipeline. Letsencrypt has a limitation on how many times you can request a certificate for the same domain during a week. So if you're testing, just use test cert flag. Certbot already comes with an Nginx plugin that can update server blocks for you and install certificates. You can always use Certbot just to obtain cert if you wish. Let's enter a real email. In case of emergency, if Letsencrypt wasn't able to renew the certificate, or in case if Letsencrypt revoked your certificate, they will send you an email. You need to agree with the term of service here. Optionally, you can share your email with the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Now Certbot has detected that you have a server block that includes your domain. Leave it blank to get certificates for all of them. Certbot was able to obtain a certificate for you from the staging environment. Let's go to the browser and check it. Now we're using HTTPS protocol instead of HTTP. We got expected error since those certificates are not valid, but we verified that the Certbot successfully detected the server block and updated it. Let's check the certificate. You can see that it has a staging prefix. Now we can get a real certificate. Run Certbot Nginx again. The only difference is here, since we already have a certificate, we have two options. Let's select Renew and Replace. It was successful again, but now with a real certificate. Let's make sure that our website can use HTTPS now. You can see a log, which means it's secure. The certificate is valid. Under Details, we can find the domain names on this certificate. Scroll down, here is a devops-by-example.io and www.devops-by-example.io, which means this certificate is valid for both of them. The last thing here is to check if automatic renewal is enabled. Let's run Certbot renew with a dry run flag to verify. We got a message, all simulated renewals succeeded. Certbot is using systemd timers instead of cron jobs. Timers provide fine-grained control of events than cron jobs. To list timers, run systemctl list timers. Certbot is scheduled to run every 12 hours. Don't worry, it will not affect your certificate quota, since it will only request a certificate if yours is about to be expired. Now, please do me a favor, like this video. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.